This afternoon we are going.
This afternoon we are going to have a demonstration of the platform. So we will see specifically a simulation of an earthquake that come in an area near Orihuela. But before doing that, I just would like to give you a brief overview of the concept of the platform. What is the sense of our work? Normally, in the in terms of software, we have two different kinds of software that deal with emergency and deal with an earthquake. On one side, there are the disaster and crisis management tool. They are generic tool, they are general purpose, they are focused on communication, on task management, they are very commercial ready, and they are very generalistic. The focus of this tool is to manage any kind of emergency, so it's not specific. On the other end, we have scientific tool. There are scientific tools for every kind of emergency. In case of earthquake, there are tools for early warning and rapid response. They are different features. They are specialistic. They are difficult to use. They are difficult to understand, at least for a non-scientist, because the result need interpretation. They are universitary. And there is a sort of wall. I mean, I have on my control room, I have the software for the disaster management. To get information, I have the other software. So, one of the focus of our proposal was close the gap between theoretical system and their practical application. So, our need, our attempt was to provide useful information that can be used immediately. And what we did, what is the Tarchi platform? We inject, I would like to say this in this way, inject the output produced by theoretical system in a crisis management platform. So we take a crisis management platform and then we integrate it to show the result of theoretical system, not only to show, but also to trigger the activities. What are, now at this point we are here, we are a GUI for decision makers and operators, and that is feeded by a scientific engine that is focused on earthquake. What the platform is designed to, anyway, is to be in the future able to be integrated with further scientific engine and to be not a generic disaster management platform, but a specific for the specific emergencies. So this is what we want to arrive. So let's have a brief overview of the functionality that I will show you later on. Of course, we have some very technical non-functional requirement. This is application that is a multi-tenant, multi-language, multi-organization. This means this it's a modern application. There are some very standard functionalities that all the platform has, user configuration, infrastructure configuration, configuration of the safe area, then we have the event management area, contact list. I will show that, but they are common functionality, they are not. Then we have some advanced, a bit advanced functionality, the two-way communication, the ability to interact with during communication, so you can answer to the request of the application without accessing the application. We have geo functionality, we have the possibility to push messages to the social media. So maybe you are a civil protection organization, you have your social channel, you have person that subscribe this social channel, you want to push message on that, you don't have to go to the social media interface, but you can go directly to the application. But anyway, what is the most advanced functionality is what comes from the scientific part. And we see and there this one. This is the very advanced tool that Abdelghany will explain you after me. So you have the chance to make simulation, you have the early warning, you have the dashboard for rapid response, you have the damage. And of course we have also a mobile part that I have already described to you, and I will go again. So just a few screenshots to focalize what we are going to see. So when we talk on Event Manager, what do we mean? We mean that we have an interface when an earthquake arrives. We have an interface that collects all the information about this earthquake. So it's difficult to add, I mean, but what communication I've made, what activities I'm doing, which infrastructure I'm impacted, which social media I've sent message to, what activities I'm doing, everything is in a unique folder. When we talk about social communication, we have the chance, the ability to push messages to the social media. So we can connect the platform to the social media channels, to Telegram, Facebook, and Twitter of the organization. So I am a civil protection organization, a rescue organization, an infrastructure organization. I have my social media, and I can integrate the platform with my social media so I can push directly the message from it. When we talk about two-way communication, it means that we have the ability to send communication from the application, but also to receive the answer. So I will receive an SMS, and I have the option to answer. Why? Because in this way, I can be aware if my rescuer or my stakeholder has received information, has answered, and is going to come. And if he doesn't answer, or he answer, I can come, I can take other action. And then we have advanced functionality on geofunctionality, for instance. In this case, we see the first result from coming from the engine. This is an interface that tells us from this earthquake what is going on. So we have the intensity map, the intensity map with that describe the possible the damaged area, and we have, you see that they are red, green, or yellow. This gives information of the suspected damages that the infrastructure has. So I can have a picture of what is going on. And of course, I have the mobile application that I have already shown, but the idea is that I can understand the extension of the earthquake. I can locate myself respect to the earthquake. I can provide observation. We are going to see, and we can receive aftershock information, replica information, and ask for help, aiuta. So when we run a simulation, we will see something like that. These are the list of infrastructure that are potentially affected. The red one are with damage probably level 4, or the yellow one are level 3 or 2, and I have the possibility to drill down, get detail, and have further information that we are not able to see, but this is the PGA, so the intensity of shake, including the overtake of the threshold, the damage, the functionality, and the number of victims. Of course, these are the added value is that you have this in something like 10 minutes, so it's elaborated by the engine, so you can have a quick overview of the suspected situation in the few minutes after the aftershock. There is also the you can map infrastructure, but also extended geo area. These are the municipalities near of the province of Alicante. In this simulation, we see that according to the engine, these are the municipality that needs help, while these are in a better situation, and the green one are without problem. And of course, you can have a further drill down also in this case. We open a damaged one. You see the vulnerability level. This is a static information. They say how the building are in this area. Then you have the damages. This is a very damaged area. Of course, it's a simulation, but it seems that all the buildings are collapsed. And also you have information on the possible injured person. So you understand what are the first action that is necessary to do. There are some further information. They are the economic loss, they are the number of debris, number of tents that you need. I'm sorry that it's not easy to read. I mean, I'm on table, I think that it is difficult also for you. And that's all before the demonstration. Now Abdelghany will give a brief overview. We will go in a deeper detail on the scientific part, on the algorithms that are underneath and what and a possible scenario of usage.
Okay, so this is basically just to show what type of result we generate. It's generated by the scientific engine. As we described this morning, so the development of the scientific engine is based on integration of the knowledge and advanced methodology that is applied for in crisis and management, disaster management. And those methodology are integrated with seismic networks, this in order to allow to generate a near real-time hazard and risk, and it is also updated with the time. In addition, the outcomes of this is integrated with a components that deals with or a system which is a decision support system that allows and facilitate the risk mitigation planning based on criteria or stakeholder preference with cost benefit analysis. So it's a combination of this. What I will show as a result is basically follow this chronological process from early warning, operational, and rapid response. This is something that I described this morning. So we will go through this to see what type of results we are getting and how this gets. The first one is to do this, we have selected Iceland as a hypothetical case study. And the area was divided into different geocodes, and the buildings, residential buildings, were aggregated in the selected town. And in the database that we have used, we also generated some kind of information related to the essential facility, like hospitals and schools. And also we have considered some kind of critical infrastructures, let's say like a bridge, tunnels, maybe highway. So this is in Iceland. And the other type of data that we considered is we have selected the existing instrumental network, which are the Mercer seismic network, Turnkey seismic network, plus existing regional or national seismic network that will be used. Now we basically generated the magnitude earthquake location. And then basically this earthquake, it will be detected by the seismic network, and then it will report the distribution of the seismic wave that travels. And then from there, immediately after the earthquakes, the first things that we generate quickly is an estimate of the ground shaking based on location, magnitude, and hypocenter of a given earthquake, because the first information we got is the location and magnitude of earthquake. So this is immediately used to generate this a quick computation of the ground shaking. This is useful for the stakeholder in order to give them an idea on the affected area. where the area that could be mostly affected by earthquakes. And this kind of results, we can plot it in terms of acceleration, big ground acceleration, as well as in terms of intensity. And here the intensity, we are following the European microseismic scale intensity. And then probably it's, you cannot read. And the intensity shows quite a very a qualitative classification of the how the earthquake was felt. Yeah. Then after that, the data from the seismic network stations start coming up, and then basically when the earthquake is propagating, then let's say maybe two or three or four or five first stations will detect it, and then they send this information to the platform, and then the engine that will take care of this is the rapid response to earthquake. It will use this information and use one of the methods that Pierre from Piaget mentioned, Bayesian network, to generate ground shaking, as well as intensity map, right? And then the more, then with this first shake map that we generate, and actually this map, it's an update of the previous one. So we'll update it based now from ground shaking data. So then we use this data to compute the impact, physical impact and socioeconomic impact. This is, for instance, an example on showing the distribution of the damage that caused by that earthquakes. And this is all as a first information that comes, let's say this comes like maybe within like 5 minutes after the earthquakes. So this should be available in the graphical interface to the decision maker. But then later, you know, more data is coming. Most stations are detecting the ground shaking because the seismic wave is traveling, and then most stations are recording. So when the stations are recording, basically we are is used to update the map, and then once the map updated, the ground shaking map updated, is again we regenerate again or re-update again the impact, the damage, fatalities, homeless. But also this information is updated also from the eyewitnesses, means from first responders or civil protection who are on the ground through the Turkey app that Alberto showed. So they can also report the damage. So this is also another way of updating those map. Right, and then there is another engine that start or activated, which is the operational earthquake forecasting. So the more event comes, so we are dictating here, this is an example of a number of the aftershocks that have been accumulated and collected by the engines, and then the engines is going to use this this information in order to generate the in combination with the static hazard map, because this is the map that is already exists before an event, which is static. So the information of this aftershock in combination with this, we start generating the daily probability of experiencing strong shaking. You see, this was the daily, the previous one was the static daily probability of exceeding the ground, exceeding the strong shaking, which was here now, based on the static data that we have. But then when there are aftershocks combined with them, then here we start see that it's increasing a little bit based on the what we have as a ground shaking. And then the more we go, then we see when we are close to the surrounding the main shock or the location of the main shock, then we see that this probability is increasing. So this is our information that are very important in order to allow the decision makers to decide what to do with this information when it comes to earthquakes and aftershocks in combination. So in summary, for what we have presented, I mean, by Alberto and me, is like as the Turnkey platform is. It's combining a state-of-the-art knowledge and then also There are different elements, new elements that we have considered, especially when it comes to having a combining decision support system with the scientific or with the computation that comes from the rapid response. This is something quite very useful for them to have it in one place. So then we have this, we have demonstrated through this case study how the engine works with all this multidisciplinary information data, which have coming from various sources in order to manage the process of disaster event. I think this is all what I wanted to show.